So Anthony is probably better known to those of you in the room as the Angry Chef, his online alter ego. And he's been a chef for 25 years now and worked in Michelin-starred kitchens and restaurants as a development chef for the food manufacturers. He's also got a background in science with a BSc, and he's hugely interested in exposing the lies and pretensions and stupidity, to quote him, in the world of food, with the help of, I believe those were your words, Anthony, with the help from Captain Evidence, Evidence Warrior, and a whole host of dietitians, nutritionists, and scientists. And he's recently released a book, or about to release a book, so I hope you've got your copies that you can sign later on for us.
No, anyway. It's not available yet.
Oh, it's not available yet, so look out for that coming soon. You might plug it when you're speaking today. So I'd now like to hand over to Anthony. Thank you very much, Anthony.
Hello. Are you all right? I'm here. This might be slightly different to a couple of talks. I'm Anthony. I'm a chef, and I do a bit of writing. I have a blog, which some of you may or may not, I know some of you have read, but some of you may or may not have read, called The Angry Chef. I'm not a scientist, so... take the stuff I say as you will. I am a chef. I am a real chef. I do work in kitchens. I currently work as a development chef for the food manufacturing industry, but I've had a number of different roles over the years. And the reason I'm here is because of this. It's because of my little blog that I write. It's called The Angry Chef, and it's about misunderstandings about science in food. Fad diets and that sort of thing, and I sort of expose people, and I've got a bit of a reputation for naming names, which not everyone does, so I sometimes get in a bit of trouble. I won't name any today. Well, I'll name a couple if you want. I write for New Scientist, and I write for The Pool, and I've written for Men's Health a few times, but they got a bit scared by some of the stuff I wrote. I write on a similar subject, so that gives me slight New Scientist. Anyway, it gives me slight Greek geek credentials for anyone who worries about that sort of thing. I have written a book. There's my book. There's some little cards and badges, and you can wear a badge if you want. It's a bit weird because it's got my name on, so having people with my name on is a bit weird. But there's a book which is coming out, it's the 29th of this month, it's done quite well. There's a professor of dietetics who's read it, and he seems to like it. So hopefully the science in there is all right. But what I'm really interested in actually is the psychology of why people make certain decisions around food. That's always really interesting to me. I work for a large food brand, and I've worked in kitchens feeding people for a long time. And I've always been curious and interested about why people make certain decisions. So the psychology of eating really, really interests me. There's a psychologist there who's read it as well. I don't know anything. I'm not a scientist. I'm not a psychologist. I'm not a dietitian. I am just a chef. I'm a bloke who cooks. But I have lots of people who help me, and I write lots of stuff with their help and try and develop an understanding from what they know. So what I want to talk about today is, we were talking about this earlier with some people here. We're all subjected to an enormous amount of information these days. It's kind of very different to when I was younger. We have constant streams of information from different social media feeds, from the internet, from all sorts of different 24-hour media outlets. We have to process an enormous amount of information every day. We have adverts and emails and all sorts of ways of receiving information now. And we have to process that, and we have to make sense of that. And because there's so much of information these days, we have to take shortcuts in order to decide what we're going to believe. And those shortcuts are very useful sometimes, so you might trust dietitians. That would be a good idea, wouldn't it? If only people did that. But we might take shortcuts about who we believe and why we believe certain things. And those shortcuts are the interesting things, and they're what can get us in trouble sometimes. I fell for one not long ago. This was someone shared this with me on Twitter, gluten-free water, and I sort of said, oh, this is ridiculous, gluten-free water. I mean, it's actually a massive hoax. There's a guy in Canada who put the website up in order to fool people like me into being outraged. So I thought, oh, that's terrible. But actually, it was a hoax Clara Gluten-Free Water is a made-up brand. But, you know, I spoke to a bloke who set it up, and he gets people ordering gluten-free water off him from their health food shops to see if they can get it delivered. But we are all susceptible to making mistakes. We do all take shortcuts. You know, I sort of reacted to this thing when it was sent to me, but then when I analysed and I thought about it for a while, I actually realised that there wasn't such a thing. It's interesting. I think what... So one of the things I really urge people to do in all my writing and in the blog is to take a little bit of time in your life to think about stuff, which I think we don't do that much anymore. I'm talking to Natasha earlier, when she's writing or studying, she has like what you have, like Facebook and lots of different things going on all the time. And we don't have enough sort of really quiet moments. When I was a chef, I used to have lots of long and boring and repetitive jobs to do, like sort of prepping boxes full of leeks or filleting like 50 different fish. And that, because I can do that quite sort of without thinking, I used to spend a lot of time thinking about stuff, which I don't think we really get time to do. And I don't anymore, because, you know, my work life has changed and I reluctantly have to interact with social media these days. And I don't have enough time to think about stuff. So what I do is I go out running every morning. I don't mind, I look like it, I'm sort of 13 stone of slightly middle-aged chef, but I do manage to get out every morning and drag my sort of aching ankles and knees around for a couple of miles. But the reason I do that is not, I'm not that bothered about fitness, I'm not that competitive. I do it because it gives me a little bit of time to think every single day. And that's the thing that actually appeals to me. It's not, some people say exercise is quite boring. For me, that's actually the reason why I enjoy doing it. I'm not saying you should all go running. I'm saying take a little bit of time and have a moment in your life that's quiet and you get some time to think. But when I'm out running, I live in, not far away, not in North Nottinghamshire. In about sort of March, April, I'm out quite early in the morning, in about March, you start to see sort of hares around in the fields. I'm going to get some stuff about food, don't worry, I'm good. it's not just talking about wildlife. I see hares around in the fields, which is quite nice. And in the March, they start doing that crazy sort of March hare thing where they start fighting each other, and they're blokes fighting over girls usually. If you get, because they go a bit crazy that time of year, you can get quite close to them when I'm running. They don't sort of notice me because they're distracted. And sometimes you see the hare, like that, sat next to a little scrape in the ground. And then in the ground, there's a pile of colourful eggs. I don't know if anyone's ever seen that. It's a bit weird, you know, obviously. They look like that. Just like that. And there's a little scrape in the ground in the field next to, near where the hares are. And they're often sat next to them. It's really tempting sometimes to try and think, well, what's actually put the eggs there? There's a hare sat next to it, and in your head you might think that's the hares actually caused the eggs to appear. And throughout medieval Europe for a very long time, people used to see this, see the hare sat next to the eggs, and a myth was created that the hares used to bring the eggs as a gift to celebrate the beginning of the spring. Because in the springtime, you see the hares there and you see the eggs, and people have thought, well, that's nice, the hares have left the eggs, and they'll take these eggs. That's quite a powerful association when you see something like that, see something close to something else. And it sort of ingrained itself into our culture. Because now, obviously, at Easter, we have rabbits which bring like these little colourful eggs. You know, obviously, you know, it's changed somewhat, but it's still an association that's remained in our culture. It's a very powerful thing when you see things together. And really what I'm trying to say is that correlation is not the same thing as causation, which I know most of you will probably understand, but I think what you really need to understand is how powerful correlation can be. Our minds are machines designed for jumping to conclusions. We like to create stories and we like to see patterns, even when we don't fully understand, and we get take the information we see, which is the hare sat next to the eggs, and we create a story. The reason why the eggs are in the ground, hares don't actually lay eggs, I'm not mad, is because these birds, anyone know what those are? No one knows. they're lapwings, which usually live out in estuaries, but when they mate, they come and they like the same sort of fields that hares do their mating in. But they're a bit more flighty than the hares, so by the time I run towards them, they've flown off. And so you just see the hares next to the eggs, and people make up a story. You don't associate the lapwings because you don't see them. Okay. The reason why the hairs appear next to the eggs, it's called something called the confounding factor. And in this case, that's the spring. It's the coming of the spring causes the hairs to appear and causes the eggs to appear, or the lapwings to lay the eggs. Okay. So that's my little nature thing. We'll talk about gluten-free. Gluten-free diet is something that I find very interesting. Something like, I don't know what the percentages are, celiac's about 1-2% of the population, non-celiac gluten sensitivity, I'm not sure, but about 3-4%, so in total about 5%. In the US, I think about 30% of people are now on a gluten-free diet or are now excluding gluten from their diet. There are a lot of people, a huge number of people, not eating gluten and associating that with health. And I think one of the reasons why that is because people sometimes mistake correlation for causation. And it's an incredibly powerful thing within our minds that makes us do this. And there's a pizza. Obviously, within a pizza, there are a lot more things than just gluten. So if you go on a gluten-free diet, you're actually doing a lot more than just taking gluten out of your diet. You're excluding all those other things. You're probably changing a lot of ways about a lot of things about what you eat. If you start taking out gluten, you're probably reading labels a bit more, paying more attention to what you're eating. So there are a lot of potential confounding factors. For some people, excluding gluten might be a good thing. But for most people, I think it's a case of dropping the microphone. drop the mic. It's a case of mistaking correlation for causation. Okay. Next thing I want to talk about is this. I don't know if anyone's ever heard about it. It's called the Sports Illustrated Curse. I don't know if anyone's heard of that at all. It's a thing that's quite well known in America. And the idea is that if you're a sports person on the cover of Sports Illustrated magazine, which is the big American sports magazine, when you've been on the cover, it tends to result afterwards. You tend to have a drop-off in form. You tend to be, sort of start not doing quite so well. And here's an example of someone who has been on the cover of Sports Illustrated quite a few times, and then afterwards had a drop-off in performance. But, and the same thing you'll see with in football, with sort of the player of the month who starts doing badly, or if a sports person gets a big sponsorship contract off them, they'll have a drop-off in performance. It's a very common thing. And what we do as people, especially in sports, if anyone's sort of into sort of analysing sports, we'll create a story about why that's the case. We'll say, oh, they've become overconfident, or the opposition's found them out, or they've changed their diet or something like this. We'll create a story which explains why they've dropped off in performance. But in reality, what's actually probably happened is a statistical event. It's called something called regression to the mean. So when you're, regression to the mean is best described as being things even out over time. So when you're doing really, really well, the next time you measure it, you're probably going to be doing slightly less well because you'll just go back to the average. When you're doing something very, very badly, you're performing below your average, the next time you'll probably improve. And that's fairly, that sort of makes sense, I think. But it's very easy to mistake that to create a story beyond regression to mean to explain it. It's something that happens very, very commonly. Similarly, if you're in a run of bad form, then, if you're sort of stuck in a rut, there's only one place you can go, really. If you're at the bottom, there's only one place you can go, and that's to sort of slightly improve. So what does that mean for food? Well, I have something, which is my Angry Chef health blogger template. If anyone's seen this or not. Okay, it goes like this. I was living an impossibly glamorous life as a whatever, PR or model or marketer or whatever. I was living at 100 miles an hour, I was eating all sorts of junk, and I was not caring what I put in my body. And then the health was really suffering. I started my insert your made up diet there, and it revolutionized my life. My friends begged us to share their recipes. And that, if you look at health blogs, that is the format, and I'm sure Natasha will agree with me, that is the format that all of them follow. Okay, what happens is they were sick, they went on a diet, things started improving, I started writing a blog. Sorry. Okay, then two possible things that could be going on here. Either they could have discovered a miracle and a secret to healthy eating, or maybe they were just feeling bad, and when they changed their diet, they sort of started regressing towards the mean. They were naturally going to improve anyway. And I think if you really look at a lot of the health blogs out there, a lot of people who claim to improve their health through diet, often it can easily be explained by a regression towards the mean, and the fact that they just naturally were going to get better anyway. I also feel that within a lot of health blogs that I look at, and I spend far too much time looking at them, to be honest, there's a real mistake. There's a real tendency to mistake an aesthetic with health. And obviously, the aesthetic these days is this idea of being thin. So anything that causes you to lose weight is automatically seen as a proxy for improving health. And I think that's generally, a lot of the time, that's really not the case. And so it's very easy for someone to claim, oh, my diet caused me to lose weight, and assume that's somehow getting healthier. But often it's not the case. And I also feel that a lot of what I see is quite retrograde, really. I mean, I don't personally think sort of young women looking impossibly glamorous in kitchens and spending all day making a salad is exactly the future that people envisage 50 years ago. It feels very much like a sort of a 1950s aesthetic, and it just seems wrong to me that's what a lot of people are idealising. And what I'm asked most often is, but it isn't all harmless. If you're just telling people to eat fuel more vegetables, what is that? What is the harm in that? Well, there is harm, and I think most people here will be aware of the sort of harm that can happen when people enter into fad diets. I'm not sure if anyone knows who that is. That's a guy called Robert Young, who's the founder of the alkaline diet. And below him is a picture of a lady called Kim Tinkham, who was stage 4 breast cancer, and Robert Young told her he could cure it with her diet, and she went on the Oprah Winfrey Show and said she was curing herself with the alkaline diet, which is basically eating vegetables and very little else. Kim Tinkham died. I mean, Robert Young is currently in Californian jail, which is a little happy footnote to that story. But there is a lot of harm to be done by claiming you can cure and help people through fad dieting. So in summary, correlation is not always causation. Hairs don't lay eggs. Things tend to even out over time, but it is incredibly difficult to spot sometimes, and it's very easy for people to be fooled. The unhealthiest diets, I always think, are diets where things are restricted. So if anyone's telling you that the restriction is a key to improved health, they probably are, without diagnosing anything, then they're probably selling you a lie. I always think if you try too hard to be healthy sometimes, that you probably won't be. I mean, I am just a chef, but people often get in touch with me and ask me about eating healthily and what's the best way to eat healthily. And so I tell them certain things. I always say, you eat lots of different stuff, you try lots of different things as much as you can, and stop worrying too much about food. I think there's too much of an obsession about food, and we should just be treating it as something we enjoy. No one food is healthy, no one food is unhealthy. Try not to worry, and learn to cook. Although it's not essential, I know a lot of people don't enjoy cooking, I mean, I do, I'm a bit obsessed with food. If you learn to cook, at least it gives you a bit of time to think every day, which is one positive. Learn to cook fish is something I always tell people as well, because fish is, generally speaking, quite healthy, and is also one of the most delicious foods on earth if it's cooked properly. And most people don't know how to cook it properly, and I sort of spend a lot of time trying to teach people not to mess around with it too much. Or failing that, you can marry a chef, which is perhaps a good idea. I don't know. Okay, thank you for listening. I'm sorry I'm not quite as angry as advertised.